Hello, I'm Paul Wakim. I am Chief of the Biostatistics and Clinical Epidemiology Service at the NIH Clinical Center. And this is a four-part talk on randomization in clinical trials. In the first part, we're going to talk about the what, why, and who. And in parts two and three, we're going to talk about how to randomize. And in part four, we'll discuss some miscellaneous points and recommendations. So let's start with the what, why, and who. So when you do a study, you start, you know, there's all these individuals that are out there with the disease or condition or disorder that you are trying to study. And then of those, some are interested in participating in the clinical trial. And of those, some will be eligible and will meet the inclusion-exclusion criteria. Of those, some will consent. And of those, they will be randomized. Those are going to be randomized. And so we're going to talk in part four about the representation of those who are randomized, the representativeness of those who are randomized. But for now, we are at the stage of randomization. So the point of the slide is to show that there is a lot going on before randomization, but this talk is about at the stage of randomization. So what is random? Random is basically having no specific pattern, so and unpredictable. So you cannot tell what the next assignment is going to be or what the next item is going to be. That's random. What is randomization? In the clinical trial context, randomization is a method based on known chance alone by which eligible and consented participants are assigned to one of the study interventions. So you have several interventions and you assign each intervention randomly by chance alone. And the participant's time of randomization is key. There is pre-randomization baseline and post-randomization. And that time is really key. Why? Why is it key? That's because before randomization, everything, all the data you collect, all the information you collect about the participant have nothing to do with the treatments because it is before randomization. But once you randomize, everything that is collected, all the information that is collected after randomization is connected, can be connected to the intervention. So that's why randomization is really a point in time where those two periods are very distinct and very important. So just a little bit of a repeat, which randomization is, which treatment condition is assigned is a result of chance. And each possible assignment has a known chance of being selected. And which treatment condition will be assigned for the next participant is unpredictable. So you can see in manuscript or in protocols, you may see this formula or this text that says 1:1. That's called the randomization ratio. So what does 1:1 mean? 1:1 means that this is a trial with two interventions, two treatment groups, and basically they're going to be, half of the participants are going to be assigned to treatment A and the other half to treatment B. That's the 1:1. The 1:1:1, if you see that, it means that this is a clinical trial that has three interventions, and that participants are going to be assigned 1/3 to treatment A, 1/3 to treatment B, and 1/3 to treatment C. If you see 1:2, that tells you that it's a trial, it's a study with two interventions, but 1/3 is assigned to A and 2/3 are assigned to B. And you're going to say, well, why would you want to do that? Well, you want to do that sometimes because, let's say, the treatment A is very extensive, very costly, very invasive. So you want to kind of have fewer participants going to treatment A, and maybe treatment B is easier, is less invasive, and therefore you want to send more participants to treatment B. And if you see 1 to 1 to 2, that tells you that you have 3 interventions, and 1/4 is going to go to treatment A, 1/4 to treatment B, and 1/2 to treatment C. So these are just examples. They are not the exclusive list of possible study designs, but these are examples of things you may see. The most common is 1 to 1 if there is, basically equal number of participants in each arm. That's the most common. So if it is a two treatment trial, it would be 1 to 1. If it's 3, it would be 1 to 1 to 1. If it's 4, same. You get the idea. So now we're going to talk about why we randomize. There are several reasons, really, why we randomize. It keeps treatment allocation free from selection bias. We don't want investigators or staff or any human being deciding who goes to which treatment. Human beings, intentionally or unintentionally, are biased. We are biased. So we want to keep the randomization, the selection, the assignment completely objective. So we let a computer program basically assign the treatment to the participants. Randomization balances intervention groups with respect to known and unknown baseline characteristics that may influence the outcome. This is very important, the known and unknown baseline characteristics. So you may say that, age group may influence the outcome, socioeconomic status may influence the outcome, and you take into account these things. But what about the unknown baseline characteristics that could influence the outcome? Randomization takes care of those as well. That's the beauty of randomization. You take care of what you know and also what you don't know that could influence the outcome. The most important reason of randomization is it allows to attribute differences in outcomes to differences in efficacy of the treatments under study. It's the causality reason. Because everything is the same. With randomization, the two groups are exactly the same or similar as possible, except for the treatment, the two different treatments or the three treatments. Everything is the same except that. So any differences in outcome measures can be attributed to the differences in efficacy of the treatment. So another way to look at randomization is you can say, well, why don't we do observational study? Why not do an observational study instead of randomized controlled trials? And bottom line is the confounding factors. Now, what does confounding factors mean? And I'm going to give you a couple of examples because I think it's an important concept to understand because it's underlining it's making the randomization all worthwhile. This to avoid or to actually eliminate confounding factors. So here's the first example. So I've got in my garden 2 plots. One gets the sun and the other one is in the shade. Okay? So I want to plant tomatoes. So I plant tomato in the sunny spot and plant tomatoes in the shaded spot. Except that I also put fertilizer in the sunny spot and I don't put fertilizer in the shaded spot. Okay, so 40 days later, my tomatoes look like this. So the question is, did the fertilizer make a difference? Well, we don't know. We don't really know because the fertilizing and the sunlight are confounded. So is it really the fertilizer that made the difference? Is it only the sun that made the difference? Or is it the combination of the two that made a difference? We don't know. The two factors, fertilizing and sunlight, are confounded. their effect cannot be separated. That's really what it is. I'm going to give you another example, which is a little bit closer to clinical trials. So you have a two-site clinical trial. And site one, let's say, is in Chicago and happens to be only for men and gets assigned treatment A. And site two is in San Diego, happens to be only for women and gets assigned treatment B. And you run the trial and treatment B is better than treatment A. Are there any confounding factors, factors that are confounded with treatment? Well, I can think of two, sex. It could be that treatment B is good for women, but is not good for men. And it could be that treatment A is not good for men, and that's why treatment B looks better. So the sex and the treatment are confounding, are confounded. You can't separate these two effects. Also, the site is a confounding factor. Chicago is different than San Diego in many respects. It's colder, it's by the lake, the other one is by the ocean. It could be the population around the clinical site is different in Chicago than in San Diego. It could be also that the staff at the site, let's say, for example, in this case, that the staff in San Diego is so much more competent than the staff in Chicago. And that's why the treatment was more effective. So these two, again, site and treatment, are confounded. You cannot separate the effect of site from the effect of treatment. Randomization, and that's really the bottom line point, randomization has to be made so that you eliminate all possible confounding factors. So who is randomized? The most common is the participants, people. People are randomized. But that's not the only way. You could have a provider, that a doctor or a nursing station that gets randomized. And we're getting to cluster randomization, and we're going to talk about this in part four, cluster randomization. Or it could be a locality. A hospital is randomized. A school is randomized. A community is randomized. But in general, participants, people, are randomized. So that's it for this segment. In summary, randomization is assigning one of the study interventions to consented participants based on chance alone. The most important reason to randomize is to be able to attribute differences in outcomes to differences in efficacy of the treatments under study. That's the causality reason. And questions to you is, does randomization guarantee representativeness of the sample of participants relative to the population with the disease? And we're going to talk about this in part four. What are the other two main reasons to randomize other than the causality reason? And what are other examples of confounding factors? Thank you for watching.